A tree called Barnstock grew in the mead hall of the Volsungs. Roots clawed deeply into the earth, branches high above the roof. The Volsungs drank in their mead hall, celebrating for their Signa was marrying Sigurd, king of the Gauts. An old man appeared at that celebration and stood by the tree. An old man wrapped in a long cloak, the brim of his hat pulled so low that nothing could be seen of his face but the tip of his nose and his long gray beard. He drew a sword, plunged it into the living wood, and spoke. This is my gift to the warrior who can draw it forth. Before he vanished, Signa saw. He took his, removed his hat, and Signa saw that he had but a single eye. Odin. Every warrior in that hall wanted that sword, that gift from the god who dispenses battle frenzy. Every warrior in that hall tried to take that sword from the tree, and every one failed until Sigmund, Signa's twin, placed his hand on the hilt, drew out the sword. It was his. Signa's new husband, King Sigurd of the Gauts, was outraged that a mere lad had succeeded where he had failed. And he took Signa away from her wedding feast the very next day, and they sailed north to Gautland, where Signa spent the longest, coldest, and loneliest winter she had ever known. By the time spring brought light and warmth back to Gautland, and she saw her family sails on the fjord, she ran down to the shore to greet them as they beached their ships. Take me home. And her father said, Signa, we did not come to steal the king's wife or his child from the looks of it. My child is a Volsung, and no Volsung will have any luck in the king's hall. But Signa's father thought that her words were nothing more than the fears of a pregnant woman. And in the hall, after the meal, King Sigurd spoke to Sigma's twin, Sigmund. I see you still have that sword. I make you the same offer I made you before. I will give you its weight in gold for it. And Sigmund replied, I make you the same answer I made you before. This is a gift from a kinsman. And indeed, the Volsungs were of the god Odin's seed. Signa saw the king signal with his eating knife. She saw the Gautish warriors arm themselves with helmets, shields, spears from beneath the straw. Father, Sigmund, beware! But it was too late. Her mother-in-law grabbed her, and she could only watch as her father crumpled around a thrust spear and collapsed in a gush of blood and death. She could only watch as all nine of her brothers ended up face down in the straw at the king's feet. She went to him. She went on her knees before him. She begged for the lives of her brothers, on the life of his unborn son. Signa, I am surprised. I would think that Volsungs would prefer death to life as thralls. She stood, looked him square in the face with her piercing, glacier-pale blue eyes. You owe me much for the death of my brother. Father, you do not want to owe me for the deaths of my brothers. I will not kill your brothers. Your brothers will not die by my hand. And the king gestured for the women to take Signa away. For 9 days, she heard nothing of the fate of her brothers. On the 10th, a thrall came to her and told her how the king had ordered the 9 Volsungs taken out into a clearing in the forest, chained together, their arms tied behind their backs, sat down with their feet trapped under a great log and left there. On the first night, a tall wolf with shining eyes came out of the forest, bit the first Volsung to death and ate him. On the second night, the wolf returned for the second Volsung. On the third night, for the third. And now only Sigmund remained. Signa went at once to the scythe woman, the woman of magic, gave her a hunk of amber, begged for help. The scythe woman gave Signa apples and cheese and a pot of honey, sprinkled with herbs and spells. Send the thrall to feed your brother, to spread the honey on his face and in his mouth. The king's mother always was too fond of sweets. The thrall spoke to Sigmund in a voice that Sigmund recognized. The thrall fed him. The thrall spread the honey on Sigmund's face as he sat there, hands and feet trapped, and put the honey in Sigmund's mouth and left him to wait through the long northern dusk, wait for the wolf, the tall wolf with shining eyes. She came out of the woods. She sniffed at him. She licked his face clean of honey, and when her tongue invaded his mouth, seeking the sweetness there, he clenched his teeth deep into the muscle. She jerked her head. He hung on. She whimpered, whined, and scrabbled. He held on. She pulled. He held on until it seemed to him that he would be pulled apart, bone from bone. He held on as his feet slid from beneath that log, and her tongue came torn out by the roots. She ran off into the dark, crying. He cleared his mouth, squirmed his way away, and hid under the nearest bush that offered shelter